This is the UK Thrashers radio show. Welcome to launch day for Moshin the Roof On. Today's guest is Evile, but before that, let's kick off with a brand new track that features on Moshin the Roof On Volume 2. This is from Acid for Blood. This is Burn, Die. Another brand new track featuring on Moshin' the Roof On. This is from one man Scottish black and thrash metal army. This is the Ripper from Night Fighter. Nothing better than starting the episode with two brand new tracks from two bands that have very generously given us some fresh out-the-box tracks for Moshin the Roof on Volume 2. Okay, next up, it's time for this week's interviewee. Let's say hello to Evile. Okay, welcome to the UK Thrashers radio show. This week in the show, we are joined by Ol and Adam from Evile. Welcome to the show, guys.
Hello.
Hello.
I don't think you need introduction, but do you want to introduce the missing members of the current Evile lineup?
Yeah, the missing ones are Ben Carter on drums and Joel Graham on the bass.
On the bass. How does it feel to be kind of leading the refreshed brand new Evile kind of going out into 2021?
It's kind of weird because it wasn't my intention. It wasn't our intention. Like when Matt left, we were just like, what are we going to do? What can we do? And it just kind of fell to me because it was the only option we felt would make sense. And I'm still getting used to it now. I mean, we haven't even rehearsed yet. And so it's going to be a strange one.
Well, with that kind of, obviously the break's been what, kind of 8 years, and, you know, you left for a bit and then, you know, kind of everything's been all around. Kind of, are you a bit worried coming back about how the band will be received, or do you think you kind of, you'll be in a pretty good place?
I'm not worried because I know the new material is strong, and the two songs we put out, as it's had better reception than we even expected. So I'm not worried at all. I think it's going to be good. It's going to be fun.
Definitely. I think with the reception, it's been really, really good. Really strong, like stronger than we thought. It might have had more hate, but seems not to have. Seems like it's very little. So I think it's going to be, I think we come back strong. So yeah.
Do you think that's just because of the really strong legacy that you've got from those years? Do you think that's part of it? You know, because there was a lot of trolls online. There's a lot of people that will kind of delight in throwing shit in your direction because they've got fuck all better to do. But, you know, you kind of managed to rise above that a little bit.
Yeah, I think years ago I used to read comments online and, like, you know, you'd concentrate on the positive ones, and then you'd read one negative one and be like, oh, shit. But it doesn't really matter anymore. As long as we enjoy it and know that it's good, it doesn't matter if people don't like it. It's their choice. But we're confident that this next album's one of the best we've done, if not the best we've done. So we're just ready to get out there, really.
With the whole vocal thing, the other bit of that, of course, was you needed a second guitarist, and you roped in the young gun who's virtually sat on top of you on the screen. What made you choose Adam? I know, obviously, he was a kind of a friend of the band through kind of being a fellow local. Did you audition him? Did you make him work for it? Or was it a bit of a kind of open door?
Well, he has to pay us monthly to be in the band. Well, when Matt left and we decided that I'd do the vocals, we were kind of stuck because we didn't know anyone, in the sense that we wanted someone local and someone we know. Anyone else, we just didn't want to, you know, we're old now, so we don't want to go through all that again. But I actually did think of Adam, but I thought, you know, he's in Riptide, that's his thing, and I just didn't think any further than that. And then Ben mentioned, why don't we just ask? So I actually did, didn't I?
Yeah. We were like, yeah, I was recording, I think, Fatal Retribution at the time. So that was like over a year ago. And that's with Riptide. And he just all called me and was like, do you want to join? And I was like, yeah. That's basically what happened.
Was there a little bit of trepidation there from you, though, Adam? You know, you kind of going in, you know, kind of playing with the big boys, for want of a better term, you know, kind of, was there a little bit of, you know, I've got a good thing here, and Riptide's really well received, and, you know, everyone,
you know, when you occasionally put out a single, because I know you're a bit fucking slow, but you know, you kind of, you get when it, everyone's really, really positive. Was it, were you a little bit kind of, oh fuck, am I gonna fuck everything up a little bit?
No, I feel like I think I'm just like, everything's a bit mental, but it's, I like chaos. And I like to work hard. If I'm not working, if I'm not doing something, then I feel like I get a bit like, what am I supposed to do? So I think with joining, it was definitely the best decision I could have made. So, and I, yeah, maybe it's a bit more chaotic, but I feel like I'm up to the job. So yeah.
Up to both jobs.
Yeah.
So, oh, back on to kind of you picking up the vocals. You've obviously your voice is very different to Matt's. You know, it's going to, you know, it has a very different tone and it's a lot grittier. Did you contemplate trying to soften it up, or was it more kind of, fuck it, this is the way I sing and this is what you're going to get?
Well, when I recorded the demo vocals, it was as a guide for Matt. So it was just really linear, you know, straightforward, one note shouting basically. And I said to Matt, like, I think we should have a bit more of an aggressive edge on this album and, you know, go for the balls. And because nothing really happened with Matt, it was just kind of left in the air. And when we decided to do me doing the vocals, and especially when we got into the studio, we tried a few different things. You know, we tried a bit of melody, we tried a bit of Hetfield, for lack of a better word, and none of it worked. It just, the style of the songs, it sounded lame doing anything other than what you hear. So, and plus, when I actually go for it with my vocals, I sound exactly like I do on the album. I couldn't do anything else. So people keep saying, oh, it sounds like Max Cavalera. And I take that as a compliment, but I'm not doing it on purpose. That is what I sound like.
Funny enough, when I was listening to the promo earlier, and it's definitely on that kind of the deathier edge of thrash, and so your Sepultura kind of references sit quite nicely, you know, the Arise era, Beneath the Remains, when kind of Sepultura on that verge between before they went all Umbongo in the Congo with Roots and stuff. But you know, there was a kind of, I can see why people pick up on that reference, because it, the whole album seems to have that more aggressive edge, you know, that a lot of, you know, not just in the vocals, but musically, it's a lot, you know, it rips your throat a little bit more than the, you know, than the last album did.
Yeah. And I think that's, I don't think it was fully on purpose, because Sepultura are one of my all time favorite bands. I listen to them constantly. If I get in my car and I think, what should I listen to? I'll always put Sepultura on, and it's always Beneath the Remains, or it's Arise, and sometimes it's Schizophrenia. So it wasn't on purpose, but I can see why it happened.
That subliminal message going in.
Yeah.
What about you, Adam? Do you do backing vocals at all on the tracks?
Not on the actual track, on the record, but live I will be. Yeah.
And is that something, you know, as you move forward, that you might rely on a little bit more? Kind of, obviously, you know, Adam can sing. So, you know, or is that kind of, is that something you'll try and play up a little bit more and use the two of you? Obviously, you don't want it to sound like Riptide, I guess. You don't want pure Adam sound across the back.
Yeah. Well, I think it'll help having Adam's vocals, because he does have that that aggressive edge to his voice. And that kind of suits the songs. So, yeah, 100%, it'll really work.
The two singles you put out so far, obviously Title Track and then Gore. What made you choose those two? Do you think they're kind of a good representation of the album as a whole, to give people a kind of a window into it?
Yeah, I think Hell Unleashed was out first because we thought it was the most direct song. It was the one that was going to punch people in the face quickest and just get the message across of what we sound like now. And Gore, I think, was the next step in showing that what we can do. Yeah, it was a tactical decision, definitely. And there is going to be a third single just before the album drops. And It's going to be, it's my favorite song on the album. I don't know about Adam, but
it is. It's my favorite too. It's going to be good.
So why kind of, you said it was tactical. Was that purely kind of a statement of intent? Was it kind of, you know, we are here, we are back, and this is, you know, again, it kind of goes out to the haters. If you're going to hate it, you're going to hate it from the first single, and, you know, let's get it out there.
Yeah, pretty much. It's what you hear is exactly what we're going to be about from now. And if you don't like it, you know, the previous four albums still exist, and go and listen to them.
It was really about kind of making that statement, making yourself kind of, this is your position and this is where you come from. Did the second track, obviously you've got Mike Posen, Mike, where the fuck did Mike come from? Brian Posen in there. How did that come about? Because he's obviously, you know, everyone knows he's a massive metalhead, and he's done his own album with tons of guest stars. How did you tap him up to come and play?
We got to know him years ago because someone sent a screenshot of him wearing an Evile shirt on TV. It was the Sarah Silverman show. And I just emailed him just like, oh, I had no idea you liked Evile. And do you want to like do some backing vocals on a song? And I think he sang on Cult on the third album. And then we just emailed him again this time around, just saying, do you want to do the same thing? But this time, I think it was, there's been some confusion because it was never meant to be like a headline or news, like featuring Brian Posehn. But because it now is, everyone's like, where is he in the video? I can't hear him. But he only did backing vocals, and we couldn't get him for the video. And it's just like, where is he? I can't hear him. he's just on backing vocals.
He's just singing along in the background for shits and giggles rather than being the same.
Yeah.
With the songwriting, you touched on it earlier on. With the songwriting, did you write all of these tracks, you know, well in advance of Adam joining the band and everything else?
Yeah, the songs were pretty much all finished quite a while ago, even before Matt left. So the thing that took the most was waiting for the vocals and lyrics from Matt, which never really came. And so when Adam joined the band, it was just a case of learn the songs that were written, basically. I think there were a few little parts of songs that needed like perfecting and everything, but it was pretty much already there.
Did you get to put your own spin on it a little bit, Adam?
No, I think I was too busy going through the back catalogue.
I was about to come on to the back catalogue, actually, because that's Adam, we're just talking about going through the back catalogue as well and learning all that. How much of that kind of the back catalogue's still going to be in the set going forward?
I think it's going to be a healthy mix because with it being a new band, it's kind of starting from square one, and I think we're allowed a bit more new material in the set as it would usually be because it's, you know, a new singer, Adam's in the band, and it's some really good songs on there. So I think it's going to be like 40% new, 60% old, maybe even 50-50, you know.
And if you had to, you know, obviously you've come back now and you've kind of gone into those songs, not only being the guitarist, but also being the vocalist. Have you had to approach it in a little bit of a different way? Have you had to kind of tweak and adjust stuff so it works with your vocal style?
For the old stuff, it's definitely difficult. There's some songs that I still don't understand how Matt did what he did. But for the new stuff, I kind of purposely did the vocals so it suited what I'd be playing, because I'm kind of new to the whole singing and playing at the same time. But I'm okay at it because I've done backing vocals before live. And yeah, I think it'll be okay.
have you had to kind of, you saying that, you know, have you been on the phone to Matt? Have you been like, how the fuck did you get all those words in that kind of beat?
Yeah, I've spoken to him and asked him, and he said it's just kind of, it happens eventually.
Oh, that's like, really helpful.
Right, yeah, but there's a song, I think it's In Dreams of Terror, where the riff goes da 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 da, but the vocals go ba 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 ba, and it's just, I can't, it's insane.
So, what about you, Adam? Have you been kind of tearing through I guess you knew a lot of it anyway because you're a fanboy, but have you kind of had to like polish it and play it the way it was supposed to be played?
Yeah, it's weird. Like I knew quite a few already just playing them, but playing them to the, you know, properly, not as just like a teen guitarist practicing or whatever. I feel like I've just by playing them, relearning them properly and learning newer ones, it's made me into a much, much better guitarist as well. So
has that made you kind of feel a bit more one with the whole, you know, has it kind of helped you fit in and see how you, I don't know what the right words are, but kind of, you know, fitting into the whole kind of the whole profile of the band by learning that back catalogue?
Yeah, I've touched upon this on Al's Twitch the other day, but basically because I've been a fan for so long and I've known the songs in that way, it's like, you know, I haven't really needed to, you know, worry about structure or it's like I know what Evile is and I kind of, it's like in me rather than, you know, I don't feel like, it's not like I've never heard of Evile before and
yeah,
I've got to learn, I don't know any of these songs. It's like, I know most of them. So it's like in, it's, you know, it's locked in already. So it's made it a lot more fun, easier and fun. So it's really cool.
Have you still got the, is there an Enter the Grave full set show coming up as well? Is that the anniversary set up in Rebellion or wherever it is?
Yes, yeah, that's Matt's going to do his last gig there. So he's going to come up for the whole of End of the Grave, and then it's going to be the new Evile play our set afterwards, I think.
Okay, so you're going to do a bit of a... So you haven't got to learn that whole End of the Grave front to back then. You've got to remind yourself how to play it all, but not you, Adam.
Yeah. Well, no, we might be doing it with Adam as well, because Adam's in the band, and I wouldn't want him to have to step off, you know. It seems silly, so you know.
You can just turn it down, mate, and leap around the stage like a lunatic. You don't need to worry. There's plenty of guitarists on there sorting the notes out.
Yeah.
So what going forward? What, you know, obviously we've been locked down, and everyone's getting kind of psycho to go out and see live shows again. Is that your kind of the last of Matt's gig and the first of yours, and then you're gonna do a run from there, hopefully, or what? You know, what else is on the horizon?
We've got some gigs scheduled before the October gig, so it's kind of just going to be shoved in there, the Rebellion gig. But beyond that, we're just going to try and get out there as much as we can. And the only things in the way of that at the moment are COVID and Brexit. And one may be sorted soon. The other one is still, you know, what's going to happen.
Yeah. It's both ways as well, though, isn't it? It's bands into the UK as much as bands going overseas. Everyone seems to be getting caught in the crossfire.
Yeah, I think a lot of bands won't want to come here, and a lot of bands won't be able to go to the EU. So it's going to be interesting.
Right, royally fucked.
Yeah.
Obviously, you've kind of you brought a bit of young blood into the band. You know, when you're at home kind of doing family stuff, Adam's, you know, cooking with Sean and other nonsense. And but what about the scene at the moment in the UK? Obviously, since you guys have been kind of on the, you know, away, lots has happened. Lots of bands have kind of come and lots have gone as well. What do you think of the scene today? Are you kind of you impressed with the strength, or?
I'll be fully honest. I'm not 100% sure because I've been so out of the scene for so long that I can't really answer. I haven't gigged properly for 8 years. It's more a question for Adam because he's been gigging and doing the Riptide stuff.
I think it's great. It's just with the whole COVID thing, it's been hard for, it's like, I feel like I've been on a break too. So, you know, we've all been on break, especially, you know, live. It feels like I haven't, you know, it feels like I can't remember even playing shows. So I feel similar to all. But with the UK scene, it's great. There's loads of great bands and, yeah.
The gigs you got booked, who have you got supporting you? Have you already got you all lined up already?
I think they're mostly festivals. I think there's a... Yeah, We've been so busy with regular life that I haven't even had a chance to look, but there's Bloodstock, which is an excellent lineup. So definitely looking forward to that. And I would have to look at my emails to see what the other ones are.
Yeah. See where else I'm going on what day.
Yeah, yeah.
You've played Bloodstock before, though, haven't you all?
Yes, we've played it 06, 08, 10, and 12.
God, and then nearly the half band.
Yeah, pretty much.
what about you, Adam? You've never done a, you didn't get through on a Metal to the Masses or anything before?
No. But yeah, this will be my first time. But
big
yeah,
trousers on flat then.
Yeah, I've just got to friggin' do it. You know, I'm not just going to be prepared and get on with it.
Kind of having the season pro around you, does it kind of help settle the nerves a bit? Are you hoping that kind of some of Ol's laid-backness will just kind of rub off on you?
Ol is like the most laid-back guy, but he also just he gets so much stuff done as well. It's crazy. Like, I feel like I've always been a very serious person. And I feel like watching Ol do his thing and, you know, get on with it and succeed is, you know, it shows that, you know, I don't need to be as serious, I think. But yeah, no, yeah,
I'm not serious.
It's great to have Ol. It's like, you know, I used to send Ol messages when I was frigging 12. Can you please give me guitar lessons? And he wouldn't respond. But now I'm here. So
is that why you made it? Yeah, because I didn't learn guitar from Ol, so it was a safe option to get in the band. Yeah. Do you want to pimp the new album out? Do you want to kind of go for release dates and out of order and all the sexy packages and kind of merch bundles that people can pick up?
Yeah, I'll let Adam do that.
He's good at them as well, isn't he?
No. Am I actually going to do it? Right. Okay. there's loads. Okay. Hell Unleashed is going to be released, the full album, on the 30th of April. Is that correct? Yes. Good. you can pre-order it at Napalm, and you can get free shipping on iSaw merch.
In the UK.
In the UK. And you can get some signed CDs in America. From
Newbery Comics.
Newbery Comics. And
that's fucking cruel. On that note.
Anything else?
What else you got? Lots of teas?
What?
Buy the album.
Buy the album in physical copy. None of this Spotify streaming nonsense.
Yes, 100%.
Yeah. I was going to talking about T-shirts and stuff. Who did the artwork for the album?
Michael Whelan.
Now,
speaking of Sepultura.
I was going to say, that's your Sepultura kind of... so how was that just a... Do you think he'll do it? Drop him an email and have a go?
Well, he did the art for Infected Nations and...
Of course.
I've stayed in touch with him ever since, and we just got talking on this album, and it all fit together. It was great.
It's quite a simple cover by, you know, lots of white space and a real, it's got a real kind of modern feel to that, you know, rather than being a very, very busy Arise type cover. It's nice to see something that kind of, you know, stands out by being a little bit simpler from that point of view, but really vivid.
Yeah, we wanted something more striking and straight to the point, and something that I think in like years to come will look more classic than, you know, all ultra metal or something ridiculous.
Ultra metal.
Yeah.
Other than that, socials. Where can people stalk you? I know you've become a bit of a Twitch junkie, which is you know, it's slightly less indecent than OnlyFans, but you know you.
You can also visit my OnlyFans.
No one can pay me enough to go there. Yeah.
Yeah, we're on Twitter at Evile, Instagram Evile Official, Facebook
Evile just UK. I just type in Evile.
Just type Evile. Just go on Google and type Evile. Yeah.
Brilliant. Do you want to give any shout outs? Anyone you'd like to scream at, take abuse before we wrap this up?
A shout out to my Mrs. Natalie, who puts up with all these interviews always going on.
It's a bloody bank holiday. Do people not know? Adam?
No. I don't know.
No.
That's just saying.
I don't know anybody.
I don't have many friends. Yeah. I just play guitar.
On that note, guys, thanks for joining us. Really looking forward to the album coming out, and hopefully I'll see you at Bloodstock, fingers crossed, and I'll see you on the road sometime really soon.
Cool. Excellent. Thank you very much.
Good luck. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Yes, UK Thrashers, this is Chris from Trapped in Purgatory, and you're listening to the UK Thrashers radio show. Get in the pit!
Okay, thanks to Ol and Adam for joining us in the virtual studio. Obviously, we can't play any Evile tracks, but instead, let's give it some Riptide love. This is their latest single, Inhuman Race. We'll be right back. Okay, next up from the metal hotbed of Suffolk, this is Killerkorp and Survival of the Fittest. Okay, next up is one of our favourite new American bands from Pennsylvania on the East Coast. This is Ultimate Power Corrupts and Severed from Reality. We'll be right back. Okay, and that's it. We're going to wrap up the episode. Quite a short one this week. It's been a busy few weeks, and I need to lie down. We're going to finish off with another brand new track from Moshin the Roof on Volume 2. This is from our friends in Blacklist, with some extra vocals and guitar work from Liam in Hellfekted and Daniel in Thrasherwolf. It's called Vengeance. We hope you enjoy it. Thank you to everyone for supporting Moshin the Roof on. Thank you to everyone for supporting the podcast, and I'll see you soon.